Thank you, Millie. Good evening, everyone, and a very warm welcome to the Frontline Club. Tonight's session is one of a series called Reflections, in which we ask leading journalists to look back on seminal moments in their careers, to look at their work, their influences, their inspirations, and in doing so, I hope, give us some insights into the craft, practice, and the future of journalism. I think we're going to get a really good insight tonight into the craft of storytelling. The way it works is that we ask our guests to select some clips that they feel have been important in some way, and then we'll talk around them. And then I promise I'll give you time for questions and answers at the end. For those of you who've been before, it's a kind of conflation of This Is Your Life and Desert Island Discs, all in the comfortable surroundings of the Frontline Club. Now, our guest this evening began his career in the BBC in 1981, where he cut his teeth in the Troubles in Northern Ireland, for 6 years in fact. He joined ITN in 1989, fairly quickly became Washington correspondent for most of the 90s, or much of the 90s, then Europe correspondent, and he is now ITN's international editor. It would be easier to name the stories that Bill hasn't covered, so exhaustive is the range and the list, but I'll give you a few. The fall of the Berlin Wall, the breakup of the Soviet Union, the First and Second Gulf Wars, the attacks on the World Trade Center, mass killings in Darfur, the death of Pope John Paul II, the siege of Beslan, earthquakes, wait for this, in Pakistan, China, San Francisco, Los Angeles, Assisi and Turkey, the Asian tsunami, and then various World Cups, Olympic Games, elections. The list is endless, absolutely endless. There is so much in that list that I haven't said. A slight disclaimer from me, as the BBC's foreign editor for most of the 90s, I very often had cause to bemoan the existence of this man. He was a real pain, I have to tell you. There are very few awards he hasn't won either. He's won Emmys, the Monte Carlo Award, the RTS Award. And then a really remarkable achievement, actually, I think. He won the BAFTA this year for the Cumbria killings. Last year, he won the BAFTA for coverage of Haiti. The year before that, he won the BAFTA for coverage of the China earthquake. How annoying is that? And then last month, he was voted Broadcasting Journalist of the Year by the London Press Club. He is quite simply one of the greatest storytellers of his generation. He is, of course, and please welcome, Bill Neely. Okay, Bill, I want to ask you a question, probably should come at the end, actually. All this sounds fantastically glamorous and wonderful. But you look at Mark Austin, George Allgaier, Ben Brown, Justin Webb, they've all hung up their spurs and gone for a more sedentary existence. Why do you keep doing this?
I still love what I do. I still love it. The one thing I would say is when you say I won the BAFTA, course, it's television. The cameraman that I worked with, the editor that edited the pictures, and indeed it was a submission that covered many of my colleagues. So, you know, it was great. It's great to win three in a row. That's fantastic. But I was just a part of a team, and that's what television is all about. And actually, that's one of the thrills of it. I love going out with the best cameramen in the world. Some of them have become very close friends. I love the challenge of putting words to pictures. I mean, I love great writers in newspapers. I think radio is fantastic. I love listening to radio news. But there's nothing quite like television. Most British people, most people in America as well, get their news from television news, and I think it is such a challenge. Because, you know, to write a great newspaper piece, I'm not saying it's easy, but you can do anything. With television, you have to work with images. You have to work with pictures. And that is a daily challenge. And to go out every day with a blank sheet of paper or a blank notebook. Yes, it's challenging. Sometimes it's absolutely terrifying, except that the deadline is, especially when the deadline is coming up in a couple of hours' time and you've got very, very little. But it's just, it's fun, actually, yeah.
What's a good cameraman, though?
Well, I know many of them at ITN. Sometimes half-decent cameramen become great cameramen. I can think of one. There's a guy who sadly has left ITN called Eugene Campbell. And when we were in Beslan, after that terrible siege and the killing of so many children, Eugene would arrive at a scene, and a lot of cameramen would just take their camera out and immediately start filming, you know, a relative here, a hole in the wall there, evidence of a massacre there. Eugene would just stand back, and for a good 5 minutes, he would take the scene in. He was actually absorbing and probably trying to lower his heart rate at that moment, and then he would quietly film, and he would be off in a corner. He disappeared sometimes. And I think, what is Eugene doing? And the images that he'd brought back, a lot of editors have said to me, and this is true of a lot of cameramen, you could almost edit the piece with the exact images that he has shot. And we have other just wonderful cameramen at ITN. You won't know their names. Tony Hemmings, Dave Harmon. They are the people through whose eyes you see the world. And sometimes all I do is to add a few words to that. So I think sometimes the role of cameramen and indeed editors is undervalued.
Okay. Let's go back to before you got your first job. Did you always know you wanted to be a journalist?
I hadn't a clue what I wanted to be. I thought I was going to be an actor. I was involved in theatre in Belfast during the Troubles. I did a very short film with Liam Neeson and Stephen Ray of the Crying Game fame.
I wish I'd known that for my introduction.
There you go. And then our little theatre company collapsed because the director went to New York and has subsequently become very very good at what he does. And I left university thinking, how am I going to earn money? And I know I've talked to Andrew Marr about this, and the two of us fell completely by accident into journalism because as ex-students we needed money to survive. That was 1981 in Belfast, the height of the hunger strikes. I went to the BBC because they said they needed people to fill in, I don't know, making coffee over the summer. And the fourth story I did was the death of a hunger striker. Because Northern Ireland in those days was on fire. Every journalist worth his or her salt was in Northern Ireland. It was the most wonderful place to learn your trade. So that's how I began in 1981. And by sort of, I started in July. By September, I thought, this is amazing. They're giving me £18 for every report I do. This is a blast. And I've just been sucked in ever since.
What did you feel you learned during that period?
That words can kill.
Meaning?
If you're standing on a street corner and you say, this ethnic group was responsible for this, and it's broadcast, it could be that 2 hours later you are responsible for someone's death because someone has heard your report or these days read your tweet or your, you know, and taken action. That was one thing I learned very quickly. I mean, I'd grown up in Northern Ireland during the Troubles. They started when I was 10. I had friends who were killed, school people in my class, people I played football with who were deliberately murdered. So I'd grown up oddly thinking that this was normal, as kids do. But I think that grounding actually in a place of conflict has subsequently given me, not no fear, I don't mean that, but a relative ease going to places where I know the place is on fire, because it's not that I'm not fazed by it, but it almost seems okay.
It's familiar.
It's part of my comfort level. It's familiar, yes, that's a better way of putting it. But no, I learned a great deal. You know, as a junior journalist, you bypass the flower shows, the obituaries, the horse fairs, and you go straight to terrible events. I mean, I wasn't trusted with court cases and terrible multiple murders to begin with, but you had to do it quite quickly.
Would you like to introduce your first piece?
First of all, apologies for the dodgy accent, the terrible haircut. It is 25 years ago. And this is one of the sort of first pieces I did as a television reporter. It's in a town called Newry. And the challenge of a piece like this is, and it's an eternal challenge for a journalist, because it's when you arrive at a place where the event is over. I had that just last month in Abbottabad in Pakistan, where bin Laden had been killed. The body was gone. The people who killed him were gone. There was only left the building. The death of Princess Diana. We arrived. We were the first into the tunnel, but there was nothing to see. The car had gone. The body was gone. There was just this void. And I arrived actually as a radio reporter to do one of my first television pieces. This is it. Okay.
Two of the three dead policemen couldn't be removed from the car they were shot in for more than 3 hours. The gunman had thrown a grenade into it. The terrorists had hidden in the porchway of Newry Cathedral during a wedding and had put on white butcher's aprons and caps. Nearby, the three policemen had opened the doors of their armor-plated car. It was a warm afternoon. The gunman walked to the car and fired at point-blank range, killing two officers instantly. The other died minutes later. They tossed their grenade, but the pin hadn't been pulled out. They ran off through hundreds of shoppers who were screaming in terror.
People were absolutely disgusted and distressed. They really were at the point of weeping, I would say, at what had happened, you know.
One of the dead was a 19-year-old constable who'd left training school just a few weeks ago. For hours after the shooting, the officer's radio remained on.
Breakdown, over.
18 policemen have now been murdered in this small town in the past 18 months. But this shooting brings Northern Ireland to an even grimmer milestone, 2,500 dead in 17 years of violence.
So,
nothing particularly remarkable about that piece, I thought, except for one thing that I was quite proud, I'm quite proud of, the use of the natural sound of the radio. I think if there's anything that stands out for me, it's that. And I think I've remembered that for a long time since. People's mobile phones going off after an explosion, that still gets me. There's something eerie and ghostly about that. I was also quite pleased with the piece to camera. I hadn't a clue what I was going to say at that point. And I rang up the newsroom and I said, is there, you know, has anything more occurred? And they said, well, yeah, there's this funny little statistic, you know, and I thought, that's it. Because that was, you know, that was one of the significant things about that triple killing, apart from the fact that it happened on a Saturday in broad daylight as policemen were enjoying the sunshine and eating ice cream. I would do that very differently today, but...
How?
I think my style there is terribly clipped. You know, at the BBC in Northern Ireland, there were, I used to joke that there were only 6 scripts you could write, and you pull out script number 3, which went, the bomb exploded at, it's been condemned by... You know, we were somewhat circumscribed by what you could say. It was a very... dodgy, perilous. It was, you know, it was war in the UK. And you had to be very, very factually correct, careful what you say. I think I might have just lightened up, if that's the wrong way of putting it, but just relaxed a little bit today. Yeah.
So your great skill, Bill, is to focus on one thing to tell a story. It strikes me that Northern Ireland, I always think Northern Ireland was a little bit like Bosnia, actually. There were individual stories the whole time, but it became quite difficult to explain the overall context of it. What's the trick to doing that for you?
I think the sad thing about reporting the troubles in Northern Ireland was that it became terribly formulaic, and that people got absolutely bored, rigid by it in the rest of the UK. So that by the time of the Hyde Park bombings, when the mainstream national media thought that the death of, or the Hyde Park bombing and the story of Sefton the horse was important, those of us who were left in Northern Ireland, who couldn't get the death of a policeman or the double killing of a Catholic couple in North Belfast onto the national news, felt terrible resentment at at that. The choice of stories sometimes when, and we've seen that in Iraq, we see it in Afghanistan, difficult sometimes to maintain the public's interest in stories that are absolutely, sometimes absolutely vital to our national interest.
You mentioned stories where there's not a lot happening. I've often heard people say to me, it's all right for Bill Neely and Matt Fry, they have these amazing stories to work with, which I profoundly disagree with, actually. But it is harder to do stories when you have no pictures. What is the trick to doing that? What's the creative trick you pull off?
To doing a story with...
With very little pictures or...
Well, sometimes the story is in the absence, or the story is in the silence. Not quite answering your question, but I remember one day George Bush Sr., first George Bush, gave a press conference in which he, as he always did brilliantly, went on and on and on talking and gave the sort of company line. But he got Norman Schwarzkopf, his top commander's name, wrong. And at one point he was asked a question, and he took, I think he took 6 or 7 seconds before he could answer it. Now for me, the story was not in what he said, but what he failed to say in those 6 or 7 seconds, and the fact that at that moment he couldn't remember his top commander's name. Similarly, you know, sometimes the story is in unexpected places. It's not often in what you've got absolutely in front of you.
Yeah. Okay, back to your career.
It's the dog that didn't bark.
Yeah, you know? Yeah. You went briefly to Sky, I think. Is that right?
I did. I'd spent all this time at the BBC, and which is a wonderful, wonderful, I still think we are blessed in Britain with BBC, Sky News, Channel 4, and ITV News. We have some of the best television news in the world, but there came a point at the BBC where I was at BBC breakfast time, I was in London doing national television, but I realized I was at the very bottom of the pecking order, and there was this crazy thing called Sky News which was going to set up, and I thought, well, number one, I can probably make a lot more money. Number two, I'm young, roll the dice. So I signed up, got more money, arrived at Austerlitz, and the place wasn't even built yet. It was a greenfield site, and I remember that first day thinking, what have I done? But I was there for 3 months before they started broadcasting, and then for the first 3 months, and it was such a blast. It was just great. You know, sometimes just to roll the dice and be in at the beginning of a new project as a young journalist is just the best thing you can do.
And then you went to ITM.
And then I was rung up on the same, 1989, I was rung up on exactly the same day by the then news editor of ITN and the guy who'd rejected my advances at the BBC, and they both offered me a great job, and I knew what the BBC was all about, and I thought, well, I'll give ITN a try. That was 1989. I started in June, and as we all know, 89 was the year of miracles, the year of revolutions. And I find myself a few months later in astonishingly being trusted to cover the fall of the Berlin Wall in November. Why I was trusted to cover that, I don't know, but what a story. I still think and you might ask me, what's the best story I've ever covered? Fall of the Berlin Wall. Just unbelievable. I was very lucky.
Okay, let's look at your next clip, Bill, which is incredibly short, we should warn people. But do you want to introduce it?
I love good writers. I'll talk about another one in just a second, but we've it's literally just 15 seconds or 20 seconds. It's Colin Baker, who is now retired from ITN. Let's just roll the clip. This is the Dunblane, when a gunman went into a school gym and killed a lot of primary one pupils. Andy Murray was a pupil at the school at the time. George Robertson, former head of NATO, sent his children to the school. But it was, we'd seen these things in America, we never thought they would happen here. But just listen to one line of Colin Baker's, because he is a master writer.
There were precious moments of indescribable relief for those who found their children safe, frightened, but alive. These are the ones tonight who may give thanks evil touched them, but just brushed past.
To me, evil brushed them, but just evil touched them, but just brushed past. His other line was, "Evil touched this town today," which was used by the head teacher, actually, in subsequent interviews. Colin Baker also came out with a line once when he was doing a story about Palestinian children in the Intifada, and he focused on a classroom of children, and he said they are learning the three R's: revenge, retribution, and retaliation. Just brilliant lines. The other clips that I was going to include, but I can tell you them very quickly. Martin Bell, for me, is my kind of hero of the one-liner and such a fantastic broadcaster. He once did a piece about, and I've only seen it once and I still remember it. He did a piece on Vukovar during the Croat-Serbian War, the Croat town of Vukovar, which was under siege by the Serbs for months, was finally opened. And journalists went in on the first day. Martin Bell was there. And his piece began with a great shot which looked like Hiroshima. And the camera panned from left to right. And he gave it a bit of time. And actually, after 3 or 4 seconds, you're thinking, what's happened to the sound? You know, there is no sound. And it was a scene just like Hiroshima. And you can think of 1,000 different lines to write at that point. We've been waiting for weeks. This is the sight the world has waited, whatever. Bell's line was, "To the victor, the prize, and the prize is a heap of rubble." I think that's brilliant. You could just sign off at that point. There's a picture, there's a script line, that's it. Or another of his lines when Soviet troops were pulling out of Czechoslovakia for the last time, the end of the Soviet occupation of Eastern Europe. And there was a great shot, again, aided by a fantastic cameraman, along of a train in a station. And it was along the train, and there were all these Russian or Soviet boys, smiling, sort of blonde-haired, happy boys, all waving goodbye. And noise of the train went and the steam went. It was just a great shot. 4 seconds later, Bell came in and he said, "They overstayed a welcome they never had." Oh, that kind of stuff just makes me, you know. And that's what I think everyone should aim to do in a television news piece. It's about communicating. You want to grab the audience right from the beginning by the lapels and never let go. And that's what Bell is brilliant at. That's what Colin Baker was brilliant at. That's what so many of my colleagues at ITN are brilliant at. And there are also people at the BBC and Sky who are quite good at it as well. But to me, Bell was, he's obviously retired now, but Bell was the master.
Can you articulate, Bill, how you do that? Because that's, I mean, is that just a natural thing that you get, or does it come with experience, or is there a technique to it, a way of looking?
Sometimes it's knowing, it's getting all the facts in your head, but so many of these great opening lines contain no facts. I remember Jeremy Thompson, when he was the Asia correspondent for ITN, after the Tiananmen Square massacre, did a line that said, "Something snapped in China today." It's summing up the atmosphere, the feeling, the essence of the story in the first line, not necessarily cramming, you know, your instinct sometimes, because you're so full of the facts that you've gathered all day long, is to say, you know, come out with statistics or quotes, or, but sometimes just trying to sum up the atmosphere, have a great first shot, a great line, maybe a bit of great natural sound, but just let the audience become, let the viewers become part of the story straight away. Don't stiff arm them and push them away with a lot of facts and a lot of things that they can't absorb straight away. Just take them in as fast as you can.
That's a fantastic description. That Dunblane piece caused a really interesting debate, I remember at the time, because Colin did a piece, it won the RTS award that year actually, didn't he? He did a piece with an extraordinary amount of sound. You could hear parents screaming, you saw them running down the road. And it was an amazingly emotional piece. And the BBC piece was done by Kate Adie, and it was very, very detached and distant from it for fear of, I think almost for fear of intruding on these people's grief. How do you get the balance right in those circumstances? Because you must do these kind of stories all the time.
It's very hard, and just as a sidebar to that, I was in Dunblane last year to do part of a documentary about tonight, and the people of Dunblane still don't want to talk about what happened, and at that point, you know, we completely respected their continuing right not to say anything about it, not to be approached by television reporters like me. Interestingly, I did watch all of the Colin Baker piece. You could hear shrieks. So at one point the camera, and there were many cameras there at the time, you see the parents running towards children who have obviously survived. Then there is a shot of a house where all the parents were gathered whose children were killed. And you can hear the most awful shrieks and moans. But at no point, interestingly, did Colin leave a hole for natural sound. He didn't point it up. He didn't want to sort of ram it down your throat. But you can hear it. In fact, I timed it. You can hear it for 18 seconds in the background. But he never paused. And I think for me that was probably right. I think, you know, I'm a great advocate of natural sound and bringing people in, but I think there are times when you just don't need to. The contrast with Kate Adie is really interesting. Kate is a great reporter, was a great reporter, but she has a certain style, and part of that is pretty icy detachment. I remember Kate doing a piece about a serial killer. And I remember thinking, I've never heard such a clipped script and such a detached, absolutely unemotional delivery. That's Kate. I spent some time with her last year. She's great fun. She's a very warm person. But as a reporter, she decided she was going to be icily detached. Everyone has their own style. Yeah.
Okay, let's just set up this next piece, Bill, because we're going to do this in a slightly different way. We've taken Bill's award-winning piece about Haiti, and we're going to deconstruct it a little bit in pieces to talk about the storytelling. So do you want to set the context for the piece?
Yes, Haiti earthquake last year. Never quite sure of the final figure. I don't really believe the Haitian government's figure, but let's say around 250,000 dead. I mean, it was pretty horrific. I'd been to Haiti many, many times, knew the country quite well, came back for this. This was day 5, I think. So I'd done at least 4 days' reports. In fact, that day we had finished our report for the day, which was going out on News at 10. And myself and Dave Harmon, my cameraman, were looking for material that would begin to build a piece for the next day, for the next day's coverage. We came upon this scene because, and we'd filmed a lot of other good things, but then I saw this area. I thought the story then was about scavengers. We were always waiting for Haiti to explode. It can be a very violent place. And there was a lot of distress, and I saw crowds of young guys digging in the rubble, and I thought they were scavenging for money, because as it subsequently turned out, it was a bank. What happened next was a story I didn't expect. Anyway, part one.
In the ruins of Haiti, the signs aren't good. It's day 6. The diggers tear at the rubble, making survival beneath unlikely. The scavengers at the bank search for money, not the living. One man looks on. Roger still believes his wife, a bank worker, just might be alive. He rushes in every time ground is cleared. This time, someone hears a noise. He calls for silence, then for his wife, Jeanette. Okay, she's there, she's alive, he says. They scrape away stones to expose a small hole and allow the first light to reach the woman in 6 days, her husband overwhelmed. I can hear Jeanette talking. I put a microphone in and ask her if she's injured.
Vous êtes blessée?
Oui, j'ai des doigts cassés.
Yes, she says. My fingers are broken.
Vous voulez de l'eau, eh?
Pour le moment, si vous pouvez me donner, oui, ça me fera grand plaisir.
She tells me she needs water. It would be a great pleasure. I'm thirsty and I can't see, she says. Then, a message for her husband. Even if I die, I love you so much. Don't forget it.
That's a fantastic introduction to. Do you want to know what happens next? So you've arrived at this. Actually, we'll do this at the end, actually. But that's the most interesting kind of narrative technique, because you're leaving the viewer with the most basic question in storytelling, which is what happened next. I was always brought up as a producer, I don't really know why, with the mantra that you always use your strongest pictures first. I think it's profoundly wrong now, and I don't think that's what you do either, do you?
Well, I don't want to give the story away, although you probably know what happens, but obviously the strongest picture would give the story away, yeah. And I thought that was the perfect example of something that you should just take in sequence. I saw this man, I thought, and he looked different from the others. He was much better dressed, he was with some very well-dressed friends, and I thought, why is he there on day 6? And I asked him, and you know, he said, I'm waiting for my wife, and I thought, that's rather strange. He said, she's alive. He was absolutely convinced she was alive. I said, how do you know? And he said, I know she's in there. So at that point, I forgot everything else that we were going to do, and we stuck with him.
How long did you stay at the scene?
Well, by this stage, it's not that far. We're into an hour and a half in, but it was worth staying there. I knew I had the next morning also, so I had a bit of time, so I could afford. But the light, as you'll see, the light was slowly dying. It was now 5:30 in the afternoon. I tried to get a camera down into the hole. He couldn't really hear her. What you heard was with the aid of a microphone, and we were able to play that sound to him, so he could hear his wife. I tried to get a camera down there, a little camera down there as well, because we thought that would be useful. The camera couldn't, it was too dark down there. I was able to find out, I didn't want to keep her talking too long, because I just thought if she talks too much, she will be weakened, but I wanted to know what her injuries were. She told me what her injuries were. That was, as you'll see, proved to be quite useful.
Okay, let's play the next part.
The risk of her dying remains. Not her husband nor anyone here has the equipment to get her out.
Would you like to take a look?
Yes, maybe. There, yeah.
They push a tiny camera into the hole. Okay. And Jeanette is revealed. Her head is moving.
So, all right, we're going to get you something to drink first.
They get her water and then begin cutting into the cables and beams around her. The light is fading. Hope is not. Then our first clear sight of her. Dust in her eyes, smiling, wincing, but alive.
Okay, all quiet.
It's amazing. She's in incredible shape for the time period she's been in there.
You confident you'll get her out?
Oh yeah, I'm very confident.
There is just one major worry now, an aftershock.
We may not have a whole lot of time. Once it goes, it goes.
Okay.
How long?
On a camera, they've seen Jeanette's hand pinned under a beam. Free it and she's free. A rescuer reaches her hand. She is in pain.
So now we really want to know what's going to happen. Can I ask a number of questions about that, Bill? Fantastically short sentences throughout that sequence. Is that something you're doing consciously, or do you just do it come naturally? What are you thinking about when you're writing sentences?
That's a good question, actually. Partly it is just leading the viewer along with the picture. This is a new angle. what are we seeing here? It's a camera. What? I mean, there's no brilliant script line there. I think it's just
Light was fading. Hope was not. I thought that was quite good. Actually.
Thank you. I'll take that. but you are just leading people on. I mean, I think short sentences are fantastic. I think long sentences with lots of sub clauses and can lose a viewer. The other decision I made, which I'm still quite pleased about, but since we're here, I'll tell you about it, is we found the Los Angeles Fire Department, or we made it happen, because she was clearly the people there honestly didn't have an idea what to do. They'd found this woman. Dave and I had been all around the city. We knew roughly where different fire crews were from different countries. And we told Roger's friend where we thought the nearest fire crew were. And when the fire crew arrived, I was actually able to brief the guy about what she told me, what her injuries were, the fact that she was talking. I said, "Do you want to hear the audio of her?" I mean, we filmed quite a lot of that, but we chose not to put it in, because to me that was actually the intrusion of the reporter when it wasn't justified, you know. So we found the fire crew were terrific. The fact was they arrived, and then.
Okay, now you find out what happens.
Hang in there, Jeanette. All right, Jeanette, we're almost there.
But within 3 hours of first hearing her voice, she emerges.
One, two, three.
Her first words, "Thank you, God," and then an astonishing moment. The words of her song, "Don't Be Afraid of Death." She told me she always thought she'd survive, but she wondered why this had happened to her.
Did you think you would live? Did you think you would live?
Live? Why not?
Well, this has been an absolutely remarkable rescue. The most remarkable thing of all is the life that's bursting from this woman's lungs. But obviously, 6 days after this earthquake, the chances of finding anyone else alive in this rubble are now very slim.
All right, nice and easy.
Jeanette Sanfour is alive, and for her husband, it's a miracle. But her survival is the exception in a city of death. She drove away as if nothing had happened to see for herself the horror that had been hidden from her. Bill Neely, ITV News, Port-au-Prince.
Fantastic piece.
She's a fantastic woman. I went to see her twice after that, once when she was in hospital, when it has to be said her spirits were not good. And I subsequently saw her on her first day back at work at the bank. I mean, she's missing fingers, but she's still singing, actually. She's absolutely amazing.
There's a lovely moment there, and for all the students here, a classic example of how to script pictures, which is instead of saying, "And then she started singing," and then an astonishing moment, and you lead on to it. This is a great thing. Lots of long gaps for natural sound there, Bill, as well. Is that something you think about when you're editing pieces?
Yes, I think I'm not one of the better people at ITN at natural sound, and hopefully we'll get a piece later on and I'll show you the real master of natural sound. It's something I have to... My essays at university were always far too long and far too crammed with everything I knew or thought I knew. I really have to stop myself. But when you hear something, it can be a door slamming, a dog barking. In fact, one of the very, very best bits of natural sound was in Gulf War I, when a sound recordist, and there aren't many of them around anymore, certainly not working with cameramen, went out with an ITN crew and did, so right at the beginning, Saddam sabotaged the oil fields, let's say. He released a lot of oil into the sea. There was a crew that went out and they were on a beach watching the oil come on shore. And the real glory of that piece was the sound of the oil kind of glooping onto the beach. There were waves of oil, and the reporter, Peter Sharp, just for 5 or 6 seconds, just let the sound, this horribly unnatural sound, flow. And it was the best thing about the piece. So yes, sometimes natural sound can be extraordinarily powerful.
Just to finish that off, but what about pieces to camera when you put yourself?
I wasn't wholly proud of that one. I mean, for me, I knew I had to do one. I knew she was on that sort of stretcher, and I knew she would only be there for about another 30 seconds, and I had to find a position, and I had to say something. I mean, you don't have to do a piece to camera, but it's nice to sort of show that you were there, and in some way, a piece to camera often sort of sums up what you want, and I just felt the most remarkable thing was the life bursting from her lungs. And then unfortunately I resorted to a bit of a cliche, which is saying it's, you know, most unlikely that someone will be pulled from the rubble, and, you know, or hope is fading, or whatever it was I said. Of course, the very next day I was at another event where another woman was pulled out and she sang, so how wrong was I? So, sometimes you're sort of so absorbed in what's going on around you that you fail to think, sometime soon I've got to do a piece to camera.
Some pieces of camera do feel quite cliched though, don't they? Did you ever see the comedy program Taking the Flak?
Yeah.
Did you ever see that?
Yes.
Where the main correspondent, they're under fire and they can't get out of this hole. And the correspondent says, don't worry, I'll do my BAFTA crouch. Where he crouches down and waits for the explosion to go off and then does the piece to camera.
Yes, yes, possibly rocking a little bit from...
Yeah. Let's move on.
Nobody I know does that.
No, I'm sure that's true. Okay, I've got a BBC piece now. Do you want to introduce this piece?
This is Jeremy Bowen, who, great reporter. In the way, I suppose, that piece takes you in quite quickly. I think this piece does too. There's a Chinese proverb: tell me and I'll forget, show me and I'll remember, involve me and I will understand. I think when you see this, you'll understand why Jeremy Bowen is very good at what he does and why he connects with viewers.
No one bothered to tell Svetlana Glavash and her mother Ruza that Svetlana's daughter was being sent to Germany. No one in authority bothered to tell them that she'd been killed either. A neighbor who heard about Vedrana's murder on the radio broke the news. This morning, as they got ready to go to the funeral, they said that Vedrana lived at the children's home because they couldn't look after her properly in their tiny, damp flat. They said they loved Vedrana, though. Her grandmother kept one of Svetlana's dolls for her. Vedrana was 2 and a half, and they went to see her as often as they could.
She had begun to walk. She couldn't talk yet, but she could play with a ball.
Svetlana and Ruza had planned to walk to the graveyard with their neighbors, but it's at least 2 miles from where they live, so with our colleagues from the Reuters news agency, we gave them a lift. When they arrived, they were told that Vedrana had already been buried half an hour early because the graveyard was being shelled by the Serbs. That was bad enough, but it got much worse. More shells started falling. One landed as the boys and girls from Vedrana's children's home arrived with their flowers. As quickly as they could, they dropped them on the graves of Vedrana and the baby boy the sniper also murdered. It was time to go. As the family was leaving, the gunners found their range. Ruza Glavash, the grandmother, was hit in the arm. Reporters tried to stop the bleeding.
Hurry up! Yeah, that was enough. Okay. Tourniquet. Another dressing. Tourniquet. Tight. Get the woman's daughter.
Another shell exploded as she was carried to the car.
Get her daughter!
The doctors said they could save Ruza's arm, but that she might lose the use of it. She tried to tell her daughter that she was all right. Svetlana is educationally subnormal and very dependent on her.
At least 6 mortar rounds landed in or around the graveyard. There were 2 direct hits just at the time that the children's funerals were due to start. The shooting isn't always this accurate, but the place is attacked nearly every day. There's no question that the Serb gunners are targeting the graveyard to kill civilians.
It's hard to find people here who believe the denials made by local Serb leaders. Shells have been landing near civilians all day. Bosnian government forces are fighting on all fronts around Sarajevo. They claim to have taken ground to the north. It all went on well into the evening. The human cost, as always here, is considerable. Jeremy Bowen, BBC News, Sarajevo.
I think that's a great piece. Personally, I'm not too keen on the start. I think the scripting could have been better. I think he sort of confuses it. It's a bit too wordy. But boy, when they're going to the funeral, you're there with them, and you're there when that appalling thing happens. When, as he said, and here's a bit of direct and controversial and partial reporting: the Serbs were deliberately targeting the graveyard. He had the courage to say that. It's pretty clear that's what was happening and that's what had happened in the past, but he had the guts to say that. He had the guts to stick with it. No piece to camera, you might say, in the graveyard. Why not? Well, I think Jeremy and a lot of other people were trying to help. You may have seen there were photographers taking pictures. There was obviously a cameraman, but there's journalists. Some are helping, some are doing their job and taking pictures. But a great piece that just takes you straight into the horror of that war.
Can I ask you a question about his piece to camera? Because I was the producer on this piece. I was in the graveyard with him. And so Jeremy says it was the Serbs what did it. Actually, the United Nations then came out about 3 weeks later and said they were certain that it was the Bosnians that did it. And so it's a really difficult thing there, isn't it? In your kind of anger, in a sense, you want to call it as it is, and yet there's always a risk of getting it wrong. Have you ever done anything you've regretted saying?
Let me think about that one. First of all, I mean, Bosnia was the great war that... if you like, divided journalists. Even the great Martin Bell, who had been so cool, so detached, so objective, decided during the Bosnian War that his was going to be the journalism of attachment, of not detachment, that he felt it was no longer possible just to say on the one hand, on the other hand, and to give everyone the same voice, because he felt there were many of the things he was seeing that were coming from one side. Ed Valiamy of The Guardian, Roy Gutman, who won the Pulitzer Prize, David Reif, who wrote a book called Slaughterhouse, which is one of the great war memoirs ever written, is full of anger and fury, principally directed, it has to be said, at the Serbs, but also directed at, and this was Martin Bell's point, at politicians. I remember Douglas Hurd dismissing the whole Balkan conflict as, you know, a 400-year-old sort of thing that we could never understand, and talking about people who say we must do something in the most disparaging terms. Do what? What do you want us to do? Well, Bell had decided that savagery and appalling acts were taking place in Europe in the 1990s. I remember one reading, he covered one particularly horrific massacre in a place called Armici, and he came out of that, he knew he had to do a piece to camera, and he was speechless. He was utterly paralyzed by the horror of it. He just did not know what to say. I don't know what he did say in the end, but sorry, now your question.
Yes.
That's right. Yeah. Thank you.
It is an extraordinary piece.
In this time and in this place, yes. I remember Bob Simon, a famous CBS reporter, saying at the end of one piece of absolute horror, American reporter, can't even remember the story, but at the end, you felt he was just running out of things to say, and he said at the end, what more can you say? Because there is no more to say after this.
What is your kind of personal philosophy about safety?
Sometimes your number's just up. I mean, Kurt Schork, who you saw putting the tourniquet on, took lots and lots of precautions. He wasn't even a sort of natural-born journalist. He came from a different career. He was very, very careful about what he did. And he was in a car along with three other journalists. Two were killed, two survived, and I think including John Swain of the Sunday Times was one of the four. I am very, very, very careful about every yard. I will not ask a cameraman to go where I will not go. I think very carefully about going another 50 meters down a street, because no story is worth a life, no image is worth a life. You think you're safe, you have no clue who's watching you. You have to be ultra, ultra cautious. Martin Bell has often said, I'm a coward. And I think actually that's a pretty good default position to be in. Yes, we want the story. God, I want to beat the competition, definitely. But am I prepared to risk my life, or even more, what would I say to the widow of the cameraman that I said, just go forward and take a peek around that corner, Dave? I couldn't justify that to her or to me. Couldn't do it.
Okay. Should we look at your next piece? Equally cheerful piece.
My next piece. Oh, yes. ITN was founded in 1955, so we're quite old. I think probably in ITN's history, no piece has had the impact that the next piece has had. It was a piece by Penny Marshall. We asked Radovan Karadzic, now on trial in The Hague for war crimes, why he wouldn't, and why the Bosnian Serbs would not let us in to not let anyone in to the various facilities or camps or whatever one, holding centers, whatever word you want to put on it, where they had detained a lot of Bosnian Muslims. And at ITN we went, and I'm sure the BBC and everyone else did it as well. Sky was just in its infancy then. Radovan Karadzic eventually gave Penny Marshall, Ian Williams of Channel 4 News, and Ed Vellamy of The Guardian permission to visit two camps where Bosnian Muslims were being held. The piece that you're about to see resulted in a court case. I was based in Washington at the time, and I spent the entire day doing copies of this piece for George Bush, for the Defense Department, for every major senator, for the Secretary of State. It was a day-long production, and it is an extraordinary piece, and it contains the single most vivid image of the Bosnian War.
This is an extract.
And so we left, our hosts fulfilling their promise to show us the second camp, Trnopolje, where 2,000 refugees are living. We were not prepared for what we saw and heard there.
How long has he been here?
Several hundred said that they'd arrived from a mosque that morning or from another detention camp, released to this refugee center after days, sometimes months, of interrogation. We asked if the allegations of beating in the detention centers were true.
I can't say much about that. See, people were hungry, that's true.
I'm not sure that I'm allowed about that. You know, can you understand me?
Tell us the truth.
Yes. Yes.
200
What happened?
So that's an extract from a much longer piece. One thing, just in the context of what we've been talking about, that stands out there is Penny says, we were not prepared for what we saw there. And then there's 18 seconds in which she says nothing. She just lets the camera and you see what she saw. In fact, there was a bit of controversy about the man whose picture was then reproduced 100,000 times, because Fikret, the man in the picture with the ribs showing, actually had TB. Penny was not to know that, and obviously that was the image that was shown. The next day, the Mirror, Daily Mirror, ran Belsen 1992 on its front page. George Bush the next day linked that piece to Nazi concentration camps. But Penny had been very careful. Her first words were quoting the Bosnian Serbs about another camp. They said, "The Bosnian Serbs don't call Omarska a concentration camp. Come in," they challenged ITN, "and see it for yourselves." I mean, throughout the piece, she is bending over backwards to be fair and to be balanced. We saw no evidence of beatings. We only heard their allegations. Tell us the truth. Finding the truth isn't easy, she says. She was given this facility. In fact, there's also an interview with the director of the camp who says these are not camps, they are centers. And again, what you didn't see earlier was in the Omarska camp, there were about 20 clearly extremely undernourished men who were brought into the canteen and given food. And the way they ate their food, there was just no question that these men had never seen food like this. So while Fikret Alec had TB, and Penny wasn't to know that at the time, the images that you'd seen before that image made it quite clear that this was not a place where they were given three meals a day. That was an immensely powerful piece because it pricked the conscience of the West, of the world. It did result in a court case because Living Marxism, small magazine, said that image of Fikret was their headline was "The Image That Fooled the World," and they said that through editing and careful camera angles, ITN had distorted the picture of the concentration camp. ITN, whether wisely or unwisely, decided to sue Living Marxism and won. It was terribly controversial because John Simpson of the BBC agreed to give evidence on behalf of Living Marxism, something that has not yet been forgiven by some people at ITN. It just caused the most enormous storm, but principally it was a great piece of journalism. They'd fought for access, they'd got access, they got in, she was fair. The images are extraordinary.
It's a great example of saying what you don't know as well as much as what you do know. Which
yes, and sometimes admitting. I mean, the hardest thing sometimes for anyone to do is to say, "I don't know." I remember John Irvine doing a piece in Banda Aceh after the tsunami, and he said they'd gone in a boat upriver, and there was a scene of devastation. And he said, "I don't know the name of this town, because but it doesn't matter, because it doesn't exist anymore." So sometimes just saying "I don't know" can be quite powerful.
Okay, should we move on?
Yes. Well, the next piece is a little offering from me. I missed the entire Bosnian conflict, but I was in Kosovo for the best part of a year and a half. We fought hard to get access to Kosovo. The Serbs weren't very keen on people going down and reporting there, so we tried to get a residency permit in a place very far away. We secured it, but we were a very, very long, we were 6 hours drive away when news of a mass shooting at a place called Racak broke on the wires. Racak was in Kosovo, an Albanian village where the KLA, the Kosovo Liberation Army, had a presence. The day before, they had opened fire on Serbs, on the Serbian MUP, the paramilitary force. The MUP had retaliated in kind, and all we knew was that the Serbs had said that 18 terrorists had died in Racak, and we arrived at the village of Racak on a cold January afternoon, just knowing that 18 terrorists had died.
On a hillside above a small village are sights you hoped never to see. Led by their relatives, I was shown body after body scattered over the frozen ground, most riddled with bullets, many terribly mutilated. All were ethnic Albanians, three brothers here who grew up together and died together in their 60s, trying to escape the attack on their village. As we approached the sunlit hilltop, the worst was to come. In a stony ditch, I counted 23 victims, mostly young men, the youngest perhaps 17, huddled together. Most had bullet wounds to the head. Slowly, those who had fled came here to find their loved ones. "Look what they've done," she cries. "It's a massacre." The villagers say these men were killed by Serbian police. Here to document the evidence, international monitors.
Second injury, center forehead.
They are military men, but they are shocked.
"This is not war as anyone knows it. These are old men, most of them, in their work clothes. And I don't know who did this, but this is not normal."
That also led to policy changes, I think, Bill.
Madeleine Albright told me that we were the only full team there, and therefore the only people to do a report that day. Madeleine Albright told me that the next day, in a council, she had decided that was the straw that broke the camel's back, the Racak massacre. There had been other mass killings before that. There was one which I know David Loyne of the Frontline Club of the BBC on the Frontline Club had covered, which involved an entire family in the Drina Valley, I seem to remember. But I think that was the tipping point. It's a report I was quite proud of. What you didn't see is there was a man called William Walker there who was the chief, at the eyes of the world, he was the chief guy in Kosovo. He was walking away from that. I said, are you not going to say anything about this? Because the world wants your, sort of, I didn't put it like that, but we want your opinion on this. And he said, no, I'll give a press conference later. I said, Mr. Walker, there are, I've just counted, 20, 30, 40 bodies here. Surely you've got to say something. And at that point, he did say, in my view, this is a massacre, this is a crime against humanity, which was the trigger, really. And NATO began bombing shortly after that, after some diplomacy.
Okay, you can see in that piece, the cameraman. It's a very, very conventional, there's a shot of a hand, a shot of a foot, a long shot of the bodies. Where do you, not ITN corporately, but where do you personally stand, Bill, over the issue of distressing images? Because we've had Martin Bell for some time now saying we don't show the reality of what's going on, and then we had this extraordinary Channel 4 documentary 2 weeks ago, which has now fueled that debate. Where do you stand on that?
Well, we have a straightforward issue in this country, which is the watershed. There are things that you can show after the watershed when it's kind of old-fashioned, when it's thought children will not be watching, and there are things at 6:30 that you simply can't show. And I have one young child. You wouldn't want her to see some of those things. We pretty much self-censor as we go along. Two of those people were beheaded. You just can't show that. I think the image of a hand, the image of a foot, I think people are perfectly capable of filling in the rest. Italian and Spanish television and Mexican television will show the lot. They'll show, you know, a head blown off, they'll show guts, they'll show absolutely everything. I don't like that. I think sometimes we are a little bit too squeamish in this country. I mean, there's a famous example from Northern Ireland of a series of bombings on Bloody Friday. At least 30, from memory, 30 bombs went off. Many people were killed. Can't remember exactly how many. I would say 9 or 10. I don't think it was large numbers, but an enormous number of people were injured. I worked on the local program that night. With about 10 minutes to go, they decided that the shot of a policeman shoveling up the remains of a person and putting the remains into a black plastic bag was okay to show at 6 o'clock. Now, that obviously deliberately contravened the watershed rule. I thought it was an immensely brave decision to make, and I thought it was absolutely the right one. It wasn't in your face, it wasn't too close up, but I think there are times when people have to know what war means, especially war that's being waged in their name. I have fought many battles in, you know, places like Iraq or Afghanistan to show important things, because we are at war there. We have brought war to certain countries, and we must show the consequences. That doesn't mean that you shove it down people's throats, but there are times when it is justified. We have a sort of rule at ITN, which again I agree with, that you mustn't show the moment of death. So you can show someone leveling a gun at someone, and at that point the picture freezes, and then you say what happens next, and I think that's absolutely fair enough. People don't need to see someone's brains flying in the air, but I think there is no hard and fast rule that you must always stick to. I think there are occasions when we could perhaps show a little bit more. People are not, you know, adults are not children. They pay their taxes for the armed forces. War is being done in their name. I think we have a duty to show some of this stuff.
Okay, we've got two more pieces. Should we show the next one?
The next one. John Irvine is, like me, from Belfast. He is one of the great writers. He is one of the most honest reporters I know. And he has for years, much to my chagrin, worked with a wonderful cameraman from Dublin called Sean Swan. This piece is about access. Sometimes what's important is not just getting the story, but getting to the story. And sometimes you fight like hell to get access to the story. They had exactly 1 hour in this helicopter to film a volcano in Iceland. So they managed to get the helicopter to persuade the pilot to go as close as possible. And boy, did they make a lot of it. I think it's great pictures, but listen to some of the script lines as well.
From 10 miles away, it's awe-inspiring. From 2 miles, it's intimidating. From just a few hundred yards, it's frightening.
This is a great view for you guys.
Indeed. We're over ground zero for the worst travel disruption the world has known since September the 11th.
This is as close as we dare go to this huge plume. The pilot is confident that a strong northerly wind is carrying this ash and steam away from the helicopter. I'll take his word for it. Oh, look at the lightning. So much energy in that. You see forks and forks of lightning quite frequently now. There's another one.
All about Magnus Gunnar River, Bilster.
You can also see big pock marks in the ice. That's pieces of molten lava going into the snow. Now look at the stuff coming off the left hand of the plume. Look at the debris there. Large pieces of rock and lightning. So much kinetic energy being released.
Unfortunately, most of what's coming out of this volcano is not molten rock landing nearby, but the fine dust that's drifting on the wind towards the rest of Europe.
And it went on in that vein. I mean, it ends when he says, basically, it was time to go. We'd been playing with fire for long enough. Very nice. And then you hear the pilot saying, Johnny says, you know, couldn't we just stay for a little bit longer? And the pilot says, no, it's getting really windy, and we've got to go. And Johnny just says, and what an ill wind it has been. He's brilliant. And again, you know, he takes his opportunities. You're given an hour in a helicopter, and you come up with that. And also using the you know, you do a piece to camera, so you saw him turning back at the camera, but just using the microphone to commentate.
It's almost a live commentary.
Just live commentary, and sometimes, you know, not many words. I mean, some of the great sports commentaries have very, very few words. I love sport, I love good commentary. Wimbledon, all those years ago, you even see it today, some fantastic rally. And at the end of it, someone plays a magnificent shot and the commentator just says, oh my word. And actually, that's all you need, because that's what you're thinking too. Or Liverpool's famous comeback Champions League final, they're down 3-0, they're down and out. Was it Steven Gerrard scored the first goal? Anyway, I can't remember. And the commentator, and it's very sort of modern commentary, he just, so the goal goes in and he just says, hello. Hello! It's great, because it just hits exactly what you're thinking at that moment, as Johnny did. Wow, look at that. But he's also informing you, he's telling you what those sparks are. He's great.
Okay, I want to leave time for some questions, Bill, so can we just move on to our final piece?
From one great ITN reporter to another, Paul Davis, when I was interviewed for the job at ITN, in 1989, they asked me who did I admire. It's a trick question. And I said Mark Austin, who was then the sports correspondent, who was tearing strips off the BBC at the time. And I'm sorry I haven't included any of Mark's pieces, because he's absolutely brilliant. And Paul Davis. Paul did just such remarkable foreign stories. He did. He was stuck in Dubrovnik once for 6 days and produced a monster piece that told the siege of Dubrovnik magnificently. He covered the Romanian revolution, and then he sort of came off the foreign beat, covered Britain. This is a piece. It's not his best piece. It's not a world-beating piece, but I've never seen Paul do a bad piece, and so many of Paul's pieces are just brilliant. What Paul does brilliantly is use silence. He's the master of natural sound and silence, certainly not me. This is about Wootton Bassett and the return of more coffins to Wootton Bassett. I know Paul had been in Wootton Bassett 8 or 9 times before he did this piece. Sometimes it's very difficult to find new lines, and also just to name the people and give the occasion what it deserves. But I think in all of his pieces, Paul does it. I think he does it in this one.
On a still summer evening in Wiltshire, the tolling bell that signalled the return of another 7 young men who served their country in a distant war and lost their lives in the process. Their family, their friends, and those who simply wanted to show respect lined Wootton Bassett High Street. From 40 Commander Royal Marines, Sergeant Stephen Derbyshire, Lance Corporal Michael Taylor, and Marine Paul Warren all died in fighting with the Taliban last week. Lance Corporal David Ramsden of the Yorkshire Regiment, Colour Sergeant Martin Horton, Private Alex Isaac, and Private Douglas Halliday of the Mercian Regiment were killed when their armoured car crashed into a canal. Their families and friends had brought roses, hundreds of them. and briefly the cortege paused to receive these gestures of love and loss. Kate Rowe carried three roses and placed them on the hearse carrying Sergeant Stephen Derbyshire, her partner and the father of their two sons. A kiss on the glass for the man she earlier described as her protector and inspiration.
In my eyes, he was invincible. He's been to Northern Ireland, he's been to Iraq. This was his third tour in Afghanistan. Ryan and Callum were his absolute life, and he doted on his boys. All he wanted to do was to look after us and make us happy and protect us. And as far as I'm concerned, he's still doing that now, but from a much better place.
With another kiss and a whispered goodbye, the solemn convoy moved on, nearing the end of the last journey home from Helmand Province, in heartbreaking scenes that we've already been warned will be repeated in the weeks ahead.
This is the 127th occasion that Wood Ambassadors turned out like this. Sadly, inevitably, there are already plans for number 128. When David Cameron warned of a hard Afghan summer ahead, this is how it's measured. Paul Davis, ITV News, Wood Ambassador.
It is deceptively simple. It's quiet. It's dignified. Paul is self-effacing. He didn't put a picture of him with the widow there. The natural sound. These lines, I mean, it's almost poetic. Who served their country in a distant war and lost their lives in the process. It scans beautifully. He's got it inside his head.
He uses his voice very well as well.
He uses his voice. It's quiet. And the piece to camera, you've only got one chance to get that right. You have got to get your voice right so that you're not an obtrusive presence upsetting the relatives. And didn't he say it beautifully? He's terrific.
Okay, I've got one more question for Bill, but perhaps you could think about questions for him. My final question, Bill, is about social media, actually. I mean, you're blogging, you're tweeting, you're on Facebook a lot. How is that changing your journalism?
About 18 months ago, when I was first advised that really I should get on the Twitter bandwagon, I thought, I am not going to tell people that I'm having a double decaf, half-calf latte with extra hazelnut. I just thought, this is silly, it's not me. Now it's just become absolutely essential. I certainly get a lot of my news by checking in with Twitter, checking in with people I trust. The revolutions in North Africa, Syria, Libya, a lot of people, their only way to get the news out is on YouTube by tweeting. It's essential. I probably don't tweet as much as I should. I mean, when I get to the scene of an event, to be honest, the first thing I'm thinking of is not I must tweet about this, but I'm with the cameraman. I'm trying to work out the best possible piece for my core job, which is the evening news at 10, lunchtime news, whatever it happens to be. But I enjoy blogging. It's a new skill, and you can give people some of the detail that you can't in 2 minutes. You can sometimes give some of the atmospherics. I remember doing an interview with President Zardari of Pakistan. The piece was fairly straightforward about him, about the threats to his life, about how he deals with that and dealt with the Pakistan floods. But what astonished me most of all were the flunkies around him, the fact that one guy went in with incense just 2 minutes before President Zardari arrived and filled the room with incense so that the president could be in a sweet-smelling place. So for me, it was actually nice to be able to write a blog about And at the BBC, I know from our own correspondent, it has been doing this for decades. It's an opportunity to be able to write and say something beyond the strict news report that you have to do. But tweeting has, it has certainly surprised me how vital it has become.
Okay, let's have some questions. Can I just two rules about questions? One, can you wait for the microphone because we're going out live on the net? And secondly, only one question each, no devious multiple questions. So,
thank you for being here. Could you describe the situation about when people die, the moment of death, and how that moment of death in terms of a video transmission would pertain to collateral murder, whether or not it's necessary or not to see those moments of death?
I'm not sure what you mean by collateral murder, but I can think of... I mean, two immediate things spring to mind. We filmed a checkpoint in Macedonia, and a Macedonian patrol was waiting. Some guys pulled up in a car. They immediately got out, threw grenades at the Macedonian patrol. There was a man in the middle of the street with a grenade in his hand, and we filmed absolutely everything. My editor told me I could use nothing. I was quite upset about that because I thought if you want to show the guts of this conflict, the ethnic tension, the tension that was there, and the ethnic hatreds indeed, then you had to show more than just the car drawing up and men getting out. And then that's all he wanted me to show, not even the grenade in the man's hand. And we had a great battle over this, which I lost. So I then was forced to go on and describe the scene. I think that's wrong. I think that's evading our responsibility sometimes to show the truth. Wasn't quite sure what you meant by collateral murder.
Like the massacre of civilians or the reporters, the Reuters reporters in the WikiLeaks release. And in a sense, I mean, I'm asking you because your position is a different position in terms of what kinds of footage you're getting. But what are the necessities regarding the public? Maybe like a higher moral authority or something.
Well, don't get me wrong. I'm not ducking the issue of showing as much as it's possible to show. I remember the footage in the WikiLeaks, the issue. We covered that story at the time. I'm pretty sure in that instance we actually showed quite a lot more than we would usually show because it was filmed from a helicopter from high up. There was no natural sound except for the helicopter pilots talking. I think in that instance we probably showed 5 or 6 seconds more than we would normally show of people actually being killed and scattering. So, as I say, it's not a hard and fast rule. And I really do, like I said, I really do think that we have a duty to show life and death, you know, warts and all, especially when it's in a war that we have chosen.
Okay, next question. Yep. Just wait for the mic. Thank you.
Bill, taking you back to the piece that you did in Kosovo and Penny's piece in the centre camp, call it what you will, how do you find the right questions to ask in those situations? Because some news reporters can be very loaded in the questions that they ask, and you always play it very neutrally, in a very restrained kind of way. I was just wondering if you could talk about how you find the right words to summon up to ask someone in that situation.
Well, there are different styles of asking questions, as we know from Newsnight, the Today programme. A generation of journalists, I think, have grown up thinking that the Paxman-esque, Humphrey-esque way of doing things is the right way to ask questions. There's a previous generation of correspondents, some of them actually ex-lawyers, who almost create traps for people, lead people gently in. Brian Walden was an interesting example. I don't know if some of the older people here will remember Brian Walden, who was very polite and would just draw you into a trap and then the trap would snap shut. I happen to think that John Humphreys in the early days of the Iraq War was absolutely right to hold politicians to account for what they had done. There was clearly division in the country. Clearly, the government was not taking account of that division in the sense that there had been the biggest protest march Britain had ever known, and yet the war went ahead. John Humphreys was absolutely right to do what he did. Jeremy Paxman did a wonderful interview with Michael Howard, asked him the same question, whatever it was, 18 times, and duly won an award for that. But I think there's a time and a place for aggressive interviewing. If I had had a Serb general at Ratchak, or a Bosnian Serb general or whatever, Serb general, I was able to ask him why he had done that, I would have enjoyed the encounter. I think it's important sometimes to ask the right questions to hold people to account. But there are different ways of doing it. Ted Koppel, who used to work for ABC's Nightline, was another great example of a lawyerly reporter who would lead people into a trap they didn't even know they were falling into.
Okay, next. Yeah, in the pink chat. Oh, as with do you next? I come to you.
I was wondering, when are you most proud of a story? Is that when it's visually very attractive, or when you beat the competition, or if you're really revealing something in a war that people don't know? I mean, what drives you most in choosing a story?
I'm proud, first of all, when it actually makes air, when it goes out. Because sometimes it's, as at least two of my producers in the back row will know, sometimes it's pretty hairy. You know, you can film wonderful things all day long. You can time it to perfection. You can have a wonderful cameraman and a wonderful editor, and then something goes wrong, or you get head clog, or you're stopped on the way to the TV station and you can't quite feed it properly and it never makes air. And that story doesn't exist. What you filmed, it's as if it didn't matter. What am I really proud of? Doing big events justice. So again, fall of the Berlin Wall, fall of the Soviet Union, things like that. I mean, you know, if you're the ITN reporter, the BBC reporter, on September the 11th, you better get that right. So obviously that. If I feel that a story that I've done does some good, that's not my prime purpose for being there, but that's a very nice feeling. I remember Pakistan earthquake 2005. We did stuff from Balakot, which was devastated, and the head of the Disasters Emergency Committee told me that every time News at 10 went out, there was a huge spike in donations, and he put a figure on it in the end, which was several million. And I felt, well, you know, that's good as well. And I also feel good about showcasing my colleagues' work. I am gifted to work with some of the most brilliant cameramen, and if I can make their images sing with a few carefully chosen words, then I'm proud of that too.
So yeah. Caress the pictures, as Martin Bell would say.
Caress as the great Martin Bell would say. Yeah.
Okay.
You've talked a lot about writing, and obviously you can't really write lives. How do you prepare for them?
Nick Robinson, who was in this seat some time ago, I don't know if any of you saw Nick. Nick is such a fantastic live performer. You will not hear an or an or a sort of or a like from Nick. Nick says he doesn't write anything down, and I believe him. Martin Bell never wrote anything down at all. His technique, sorry to just digress for a minute, his technique was to walk up and down outside the edit suite. When a few pictures had been taken, put down, he would go in, he'd pick up the microphone, and he'd say roll, and he would voice a little bit, and then he'd go out and have another think. So he didn't write anything down. I don't write absolutely everything down, but I have a tendency to slightly learn what I'm going to say. The danger in that is, and it very, very often happens, the program editor will say in your ear just before you're about to do, I know I gave you a minute, but I can only take 40 seconds. And you're suddenly thinking, you know, 10, 9, 8, you're thinking, what 20 seconds will I drop? So there are dangers in scripting something. I know Nick doesn't. He just thinks of the two or three things that he wants to say. And because he's absolutely brilliant, he carries it off with such panache. I am afraid I'm a bit more of a plotter, so I write things down and then I try my best to deliver them. Sometimes it works, and most of the time it works. Yeah.
Over yeah. Over here.
Hi. You've talked about some great opening lines to a piece. What do you bear in mind to close it? I'm not talking about if you're sort of plonked on the end for a piece to camera. How do you draw a TV report to a close?
Well, I came into TV with no journalism with no journalistic training whatsoever. So I brought the techniques of the university essay with me, which is that often your opening is to sort of introduce people to what you're about to see, and your conclusion is somehow a conclusion. It's somehow summing up what you've just discussed. I suppose the closing lines might try to sum up what you've just seen, or they might throw things forward. So whatever you've seen here, whatever you've seen today, it's not over. Just to give viewers a sense that this is a continuing story. You're not appealing to them to watch the program tomorrow, but you that would be one technique. You might try and push it forward as well. But again, I think, you know, even at the end, you're looking for I'm certainly looking for the kind of the killer line. Of course, the end of the piece is usually with about a minute and a half to go to the feed. So your adrenaline is just pumping and you're just thinking, I've got to say something. And quite often you just say anything at all and then the sign off, and then it goes in the machine and the button's pressed and it's being sent. But ideally, you're trying again something that will. I'm struggling to remember a great closing line. If I remember one, I will tell you. Yeah.
You don't say only time will tell. Let me say that.
No. No.
One down here.
Thanks.
You mentioned at the start of your interview that you've changed your reporting style. You've relaxed a lot more. What would you say audiences expect of reporters these days, and how have you adapted your style to that?
I think when I started, television reporting was much more sort of clipped and, if you like, declamatory. You know, we were there to make a series of statements. They were facts: the who, the what, the where, the when, the why, and the how. And we had a couple of Martin Bell pieces which we haven't played of him in the 1970s. They are extraordinary. There's the clipped accent and the clipped sentence. I think journalists now are much more, we talk in a much more relaxed way. John Irvine is brilliant at this. There's a great piece to camera with a great line in it that John Irvine does, which somewhat illustrates the point. He's walking, it's Haiti, the earthquake. He's in a hospital which is full of awful, awful scenes. And he's just walking along and he says, if you ever want to know what the phrase desperately in need of help looks like, look no further. It's just an easy conversational way of saying things. Tom Bradby, who's our political editor, friend of the Middletons, best-selling author, I don't hate him, not for a moment, has a very very different style from Nick Robinson. They're both brilliant at what they do, but Tom's style is very conversational. You know, he'll often start a piece just saying, you know, imagine you're the Prime Minister, which isn't the way, I mean, he'd have been sort of thrown out of ITN, the BBC, and everywhere else 30 years ago for starting a piece like that. In fact, just a quick anecdote, I remember an American reporter came to the BBC in Belfast, and like I said, we had six ways of telling the story. The bomb exploded at, it's been condemned by, you know, it was all very rigid, and there were lots of grizzled old blokes who would, you know, tell you off if you did anything different. This guy comes from New York. He was on secondment from ABC. And he started off a script, and he was very laid back. This is the 1980s, and he said, whatever way you look at it, Declan Donaghy is in a heap of trouble. Well, needless to say, the piece did not go out. And actually, I think now, well, really kind of, what was wrong with that, you know? I know what was wrong with it at the time, but I think things have just loosened up in lots of ways, and I think that's a good thing. Yeah.
You spoke earlier about how words can kill, and obviously sometimes your presence in places might kill as well. And I was just wondering if you know of any examples where people have talked to you and then their lives have been put very much in danger.
I can think of one last, very recently. I'm about to go to Tripoli again, and the last time I was in Tripoli a couple of months ago, we went to a suburb of Tripoli called Tadjoura. We made very, we were very careful. We'd escaped from the hotel and escaped from our minders. We'd got in a taxi. We made very sure that we weren't being followed. We took back routes around alleyways and eventually came to a group of people who had just been to the funeral of someone who was killed in protests. Those people were very, very scared. Not just scared on the day, but scared that we had come in contact with them. A couple of them would do interviews. I said, if you are worried for a moment that you are going to be somehow identified, let's do it back to camera, let's do it off camera, I'll do it any way you want, and frankly, have a think about it in the next 10 seconds, and if you decide that you don't want to do it, I'll go away. Some of them wanted to give me telephone numbers, email addresses. I was very, very careful about where I kept those. I was with a young man one night who'd taken us from a hotel, from the Rixos Hotel, to another hotel where our live broadcast was, and he brought us back. He was a taxi driver. We were stopped at a checkpoint. 40 minutes later, we were still there, and he was about 26, 27. I have never seen a young guy shake so badly. He was making the car shake. He just said, oh my God, we said, it's all right, we'll, you know, we'll, and I knew at the time the very fact that he was with us was had put him in danger, so I was trying to reassure him. I said, we'll ring you tomorrow, give me your telephone number. No, I'm not giving you a telephone number. I said, give me any way possible that I can follow up what happens to you when you drop me off. There's no easy solution. I understand your question. We really, really try our best because we fly away from these places, leaving behind very often the translators, the fixers. The British Army left Basra, and I did an interview with a man who had been a British Army translator for years. Again, a man who was terrified because so many of his colleagues had been killed. So we don't play that down for one second, that our very presence can cause people to be in danger.
Yeah. Okay, last question. Yeah, over the back.
We saw two fairly understandable examples of journalists involving themselves in the story, you in Haiti and Jeremy Bowen. Where do you draw the line as a journalist in between telling a story and becoming involved in it?
It's a very good question. We had an editor in at ITN 10 years ago or so when, I'm not sure if he invented the phrase, but reporter involvement became the thing. There were so many news agencies and video sources, and indeed I remember in my first 3 months at Sky, I didn't leave Sky Australia, but I was doing lots of foreign reports, and I was doing 2 or 3 minutes on this and that, and to the viewer they might have thought I was there. So there were lots of picture sources, and there came a moment when our editors decided that we had to show that we too were there, and that we were gathering this news, and that we were a source that could be trusted because we were there. I think we took that way too far. I remember one report done by Terry Lloyd, who subsequently was killed in Iraq, which was put in for a war correspondence report. And the jury apparently laughed because he was in virtually every shot. And they said, you're not telling us the story of how Kosovar Albanians fled Kosovo, you're telling us the story of your reporter who was with them. What kind of journalism is that? So I think there was a point where we went, and one can go too far. I think also there is a danger on the opposite side of being too detached, of being icily cold, of almost pretending that you're not there until you're up piece to camera for 10 seconds and then you're gone. I think there's a balance to be struck between, yes, the journalism of detachment and the journalism of attachment. And I think by and large, pretty much we all get it right. I mean, there are reporters who will want to put themselves in the scene more than other reporters. Paul Davis is one who I think is terribly self-effacing. There are others who I won't name who, you know, are maybe more egotistical, who want to show off, as it were. I don't particularly agree with that kind of journalism. But
okay, one last question from me, Bill. One of your kids comes to you and says, "Dad, I want to be a journalist." Are you pleased? Are you going to encourage them?
I've got two daughters. They would have been led astray by too many years of listening to me, you know, talk excitedly about the places I've been and the things I've seen. One of my daughters actually did want to be a documentary maker, and she's since seen sense, and she wants to be a management consultant. So, good for her.
No need for.
I would say, I mean, yes and no. Look, I don't know how many of you are students. It is the most wonderful career. I don't regret for a moment that I do what I do. It's fun, it's important. I'm a history and English graduate. I'm there at the front line of history many, many times. I've seen things that I could bore you with for the next 6 hours. It's been exciting. If you love a bit of adventure, it's great. If you're a foreign correspondent, it is a wonderful, wonderful life, and I've been privileged to be part of it, and I have to thank ITN, especially for the last, you know, 20 plus years of allowing me to go to these places.
Well, I think we could all be bored for another 6 hours, actually. I'd like to thank Angelique from the BBC, who stepped in at the very last minute to play the slides. Millicent and the team from the Frontline Club, all of you for your questions, but most of all, Bill Neely.